Welcome to Boating Georgian Bay TV.
Now, first of all, my name is Mark. I'm a historic interpreter here at Fort Mackinac for the 1880s, when this was still a working military installation, as well as our nation's second national park after Yellowstone out west. Now, inside today, rain or shine, we do have lots and lots of events going on. So cannon firings, rifle demonstrations, musical demonstrations, lots of fun interactive activities too. All of our buildings inside are original buildings, dating back into the 1800s, even a couple from the 1700s, when the British first built Fort Mackinac during the American Revolution. Now, we also have the Tea Room, which is a wonderful full-service restaurant run by the Grand Hotel in there.
So here we are at the Grand Hotel. It's not to be missed. We're going to stay here for a night just to see what it's like. They have a fabulous dining room. Jacket and tie, the dining room only. Beautiful grounds here around the area. You can come and visit it, pay $10 and get an admission just to see inside the hotel. World's longest veranda. So here we are in our suite in the Grand Hotel. This hotel is just spectacular. I mean, it's worth coming to Mackinac just to see the hotel. Every room's different, beautifully decorated, very colorful, overlooking the gardens down below, just gorgeous. Very unusual room design. Two little alcoves up the stairs, one for dining and one for relaxing. Modern conveniences. Even though it's a historic hotel, you know, it's got everything you'd want here. It's very, very, very modern, and Wi-Fi and electronics. And the interesting thing is this hotel was built in just 93 days. So just look at the view from this room. It's just spectacular. We're looking out over the water and down at the pool. So we're here in the cupola. Bar, one of many bars, many restaurants in the Grand Hotel, and this is a two-story bar. There's another story up there, and as you can see, it has a gorgeous view out over the water. I'm here today with Jared Chartron from North Star Marina. Jared, tell me about your background with the marina and how long you've been in business and things like that.
Well, North Star Marine Insurance has been in business now. We're starting our 10th year at the Toronto Boat Show in January. We started the company 9 years ago, and our mandate was to provide boat insurance for the residents of Ontario and get them on the water as quickly and as efficiently as possible with the best coverage available.
And you started the business from the very beginning? You started from scratch?
Yeah, I was working for another insurance provider that specialized in marine insurance, and they made some changes, so I looked to start my own company, and with a partner, I launched the company 9 years ago.
Fantastic. So, Jared, what's the most common type of claim that you see?
Traditionally, what we see throughout the season is somebody hitting impact with bottom or floating log. That seems to be the most common claim. After that, it would be storm damage. So, weather is always changing, and Southern Ontario especially gets pretty wicked storms blow up, and if your boat is tied up at a dock or sitting on a trailer, you know, sometimes Mother Nature can come across and do a lot of damage to your boat.
So Jared, as far as storm damage, you know, you're talking about not so much boats that drag at anchor and end up on the rocks, but more damage on the docks being very common, is that right?
That's right, yeah. Most people are pretty conscious about the weather, and when they see a storm heading their way, they get back into safe harbor. Once the boats are tied up, that's when we traditionally see the storm damage occur, because Mother Nature sort of pushes the water and the wind in their direction, and their lines and anchors can't handle it, and they come detached from the docks and can end up damaged as a result of the storm.
So, Jared, what about boats traveling to the U.S. that are Canadian boats that have a policy here? Is there a rider, or how does that work if they were to go down to Florida, let's say?
Yeah, our policy basically covers the boat or inland waterways in Canada as far south as the Port of New York or the 40th parallel, as commonly known in the policy wordings. So if you're heading south, you just contact your insurance broker to let them know the time frame you're planning on going, and we can add an extension to the policy through our office if you wanted to get the coverage extended during that period of time.
And would that, is there something that would allow them even to go over to the Bahamas?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. So we can extend Florida, Bahamas, and into the Caribbean.
Good. Jared, what are some of the things that boaters often overlook when it comes to insurance policies? Things that maybe they wouldn't be aware of that they should be aware of, or things that maybe, you know, they thought they had covered or that isn't covered except without a rider, things like that that might be surprises that they wouldn't know.
Yeah, the most common problem that boat owners face is they're so excited when they get their new boat that they rush to buy a policy. They don't spend a lot of time investigating what the coverage is actually included. There's two different types of policies on the market. There's an agreed value or an actual cash value policy. Those are the two types we sell here at our office. And we try and encourage customers to get the agreed value policy because it does provide the best protection in the event of a claim. If you were to add the boat to your homeowner's policy, it would be listed as a rider, and the coverage is quite limited compared to what you'd get on a standard marine policy.
So, Jared, if somebody, you know, in the worst case scenario, they have a total loss of their vessel, let's say it sinks to the bottom, or you know, it's wrecked in an accident or something like that. How do you evaluate the boat? Is it like current market value, or do they buy the policy for replacement, or are there options there, or how does that work exactly?
So there's three coverages that will come into play. So if you have an agreed value policy, there's a limit listed on the policy declaration page, and that's what the company would pay out in the event of a total loss. Even if the boat has depreciated over time, you get what the policy states the boat's worth. If the loss occurred within the first 3 years and you purchased an inflation guard, you can also get coverage to replace the boat and the insurance company would pay the inflation. If you didn't have that type of policy, the other common coverage would be an actual cash value policy. How that coverage would respond is the claim occurs, the policy states the boat's worth, say $10,000. After the boat's evaluated by the adjuster, it's determined that the boat's actually only worth $4,000. They pay the depreciated value.
Now, is there a survey that has to take place for that kind of coverage, or is it just, you know, within the realm of what seems to be a reasonable figure for the value of a boat when they state their boat value?
Insurance companies would ask for an out-of-water marine survey once the boat hits 15 years of age. Mm-hmm. Some companies will extend it to 20 years of age, so that's when a survey would be required in order to get your agreed value protection.
Can you tell me about any interesting stories that without naming names, any interesting stories about insurance claims like that you can think about over the years that, you know, like really weird ones? Or
well, we've certainly seen our fair share. Most common, as I've said before, someone's driving along, they're in an area where they thought there's plenty of water, and they run aground and do some damage to the boat. And usually the customer's back on the water just as soon as it can possibly be repaired. As far as stories, well, there's lots of them, but for privacy, I like to sort of not go into too many details, but absolutely the most common is, you know, we're driving along, nice sunny day, no one's even thinking about having a problem, and all of a sudden that rock sort of pops up that they never expected to be there.
Any limitations on the size of boats that you'll insure? Is there?
No, we'll do anything from a personal watercraft to a million-dollar yacht and everything in between. Of course, the more expensive boats are a little more challenging because insurance companies want to protect their investment in that policy, so they want to know a lot more detail as far as ability to operate, where the boat's going to be stored, certainly where you're planning on using your boat if you're planning on going south. So it can be a little bit more complicated, but at the end of the day, usually within 24 hours, we can get you quoted and covered.
So Jared, as I understand it, insurance companies are licensed for particular provinces, and you handle the whole province of Ontario, is that correct?
That is correct, yeah. We focus exclusively on Ontario. It's the largest boat market for consumer boating, and that's the area we've chosen to focus our energy on. And until we've been able to conquer that market, I don't think there's a reason to go outside of Ontario.
And is there a lot of competition in the marine insurance market, or is it, there's very few companies that really specialize in marine insurance, is that correct?
There's a few insurers that do it. There's lots of brokerages like Northstar that do it.
What happens seasonally? Do you find that business is like going crazy in the spring and it drops off in the fall, or are people in Canada now buying boats, you know, all at all times of the year, putting insurance on the boats?
Certainly we get lots of inquiries early in the season during boat show cycle. And then, of course, coverage starts to go into effect early spring and throughout the entire summer.
Any advantages if somebody has a multiple watercraft, let's say a boat and a Sea-Doo, or a bigger boat and a smaller boat, that kind of thing? Any advantages to bundling, or is it straight, you know, evaluation of the boat and what the boat's worth, and it's pretty fixed in terms of the rates as they go? Or?
It certainly is fixed. You do qualify for a claims-free discount if you've got prior boat insurance and you transfer it to every policy that you have. So there is an advantage there. You get a 10% discount every time you add a boat to the package.
Now, they can get quotes right off the web directly, and is that how that works?
Yeah, absolutely. So if you visit our website, you'll see that there's a quote request form, www.northstarinsurance.ca. We'll be happy to help and provide you a no-obligation quote, give you all the information you need to get competitive coverage for your boat and enjoy the season on the water.
So we're here at the beautiful Y Marina with Carol and my friend Joe, Monica, and Dave. And these folks have been on the bay a long time, so I thought our viewers could benefit from their experience. And maybe just to start things off, you could all tell us a little bit about how you found your way to the bay and how long you've been boating here. And we'll go from there. So Joe, how did you find your way up to Georgian Bay, and how long you've been boating on Georgian Bay?
I've been boating on Georgian Bay for about 30 years. Found our way up as a referral a long time ago when we bought our first larger boat that was not trailerable, and enjoyed it since then.
And tell me a little bit about your boat now.
We've had this boat for 16 years. It's a 41-foot mainship, and you know, we bought at a time when our daughter liked to come up with her friends, but that waned very quickly. So it's probably not the perfect boat for us right now because it does have a lot of interior space, and we enjoy the exterior space a little bit more.
So, Dave, what about you folks? How long have you been on the bay, and how did you find your way here?
Okay, we've been on the bay also for about 30 years. We actually used to camp here when we were a lot younger, camp up in the Parry Sound area, and we graduated from that to small runabouts and then to liveaboards in the late 90s. And we've been operating here out of Penetanguishene and Midland since 96.
Okay, and what's your current boat?
The current boat is a 43-foot Silverton aft cabin.
So, folks, tell me about some of your favorite anchorages. Maybe we'll start with Joe, with you, and what you think, and then we'll get the ladies to chime in, and then we'll have Dave pick one too. So what's your favorite, Joe?
Oh, there are so many. I think basically they break down into sort of gunk hole anchoring and blue water anchoring. If we want beaches and blue water and surf, we'll anchor at the east side of Christian Island, south side of Hope, or the west side of Beckwith. If we want gunk holing and, you know, interesting dinghying, that sort of thing, we'll go to the Moon River area. Those are probably our favorites.
Yes, I would say so.
Is that, you concur, Carol? Or you
I just, absolutely yeah, concur.
Those are your favorites too, eh?
Yep.
Okay.
Yep.
And Monica, what about you?
My favorite would be farther north, Henvey Channel. Absolutely beautiful rock faces and crystal clear water. Yeah.
What do you say, Dave?
Yeah, I'd just like to echo kind of what Joe said. There's so many beautiful anchorages up here. They don't call it the 30,000 Islands for nothing. You know, we early in the season, we'll go up to Bone Island and drop the anchor there for a few days. We'll go to Christian, you know, if the conditions are right with the winds. The Massasauga Park is just outstanding. It's only like a 3-hour cruise from here. It's just endless, and there can be a gale on in Georgian Bay, and you can find a beautiful little anchorage just about anywhere all up that coast.
Good point, good point. Yeah, good point, Dave.
So, Joe, we've traveled together by boat a few times, and just kind of recollecting, we're not trying to scare our audience here or anything, but, you know, Georgian Bay can be pretty unusual sometimes, and I remember that one time, I think, was heading north on a nice sunny morning, and all of a sudden the fog rolled in and we could hardly see the bow of the boat, and you were leading the pack. I think it was a rendezvous we were on, and then probably 6 or 8 or 10 boats or something like that. And so it was Mother Goose style, and you were leading the pack, and we were well offshore on the way to Magnetawan, is that right?
We were, yeah. We were in the, I'll never forget that day. We were on the final approach of the small craft route to the mouth of the Magnetawan River, and we were heading in, and we were probably about 5 miles and several critical turns away from where we needed to end up, and the fog rolled in and we had pretty much boat length visibility.
And that channel was a fairly narrow channel, and it's out of sight of land, which people's, you know, some people don't understand about Georgian Bay. You can be out of sight of land and still be in a channel heading to a destination.
We were probably about 8 miles offshore, and somewhere I'm working our way in. You can't, very different than the other Great Lakes like Lake Ontario or Lake Erie, you can't just decide where you're going to go. Once you're in something like that, you have to stay in the navigational areas, otherwise you'll the outcome's
could be bad.
Very bad, yes.
and of course at that time, you know, you were picking off all those boys by radar because the fog was so thick that you couldn't see anything else.
And my wife with the binoculars.
Binoculars.
When it gets like that, and you know how tight it is, it can get in some spots. You know, situational awareness is number one. You have to know where you are, and you use a little bit of everything. You know, we worked our way in. The first thing we did, as you recall, is closed up.
Yes.
Closed up so that somebody is not on another side of a boulder or another side of a main rock.
Yeah.
And to close ranks and come in and go slow. Yeah. And, you know.
And that was the second time we hit fog on that trip, if I recall. The first one wasn't as bad, but it was
unusual.
Carp Diem, I think, was leading the pack that day.
Yes.
Yeah, that was a lot of fun. Yeah.
Yeah.
So, Dave, in all your years, did you have any particularly perilous situations on Georgian Bay?
Well, we've had a couple. I think the one that comes to mind most clearly for us is we tried to make a run from Penetanguishene up to Killarney on a Sunday, on a day that seemed like it would be okay to do it. We did listen to the weather, and the weather on the VHF channel was indicating that there was going to be some storms in northern Georgian Bay, but it seemed like they would have cleared through before we got up there.
We were going offshore all the way up.
We were going offshore. We went out to Hope Island and made a straight line up, and we got about halfway up, and well, that storm wasn't gone, and we got right into the thick of it, and got hammered pretty hard, and had to abort, and wound our way into Point of Barrel, and just as we got in close to where the shoals are, we lost our mapping software, so it got a bit hairy on the bridge for a few minutes, and I remember going at that time we were in a 46-foot Maxim sport fisher type boat, and I went from the bridge down to the cockpit. There had been a hell of a racket back there, and I mean, when I stood in the cockpit and looked up, I couldn't see over the waves that were coming up behind us, and one wave had hit the back of the boat and cocked the dinghy that was on the lift, and it was still okay, but we eventually did get in, and almost went over a great big log in the entrance to Point of Barrel, but it was certainly time for a good stiff drink once we got in behind the rocks.
You celebrated your survival.
Yes, we did, yeah. It's a great story to tell later on. not so much at the time.
Yeah.
I'm here with Lee at the Red Path Waterfront Festival. Lee, tell me a little bit about what's going on here.
Well, it's an annual event that takes place, of course, on Toronto's waterfront. And we have a very variety of programs every year, but this year we're delighted because we're welcoming the Royal Canadian Navy for the first time to our event, as well as it's a tall ships year. So we've got international tall ships that will be here. We've got the El Galeon, which is a Spanish vessel with 5 decks of exhibits. So it's almost like a floating museum. And we've got Draken, which is the world's largest Viking ship built in modern time. And they have traveled all the way from Norway across the North Atlantic to be with us this weekend. So we're very excited. We also have the American ship Pride of Baltimore too. And we have a whole bunch of on-land programming. We've got the Argo stage that will have a lot of entertainment. We also have the Waterfront Artisan Market with over 50 booths. And then we go down to Harbor Square Park where the Navy is, and there's going to be the Urban Fresh Navy Cook-Off tomorrow, where 2 chefs, one from the Atlantic Coast and one from the Pacific Coast, are going to compete in a black box style competition. And there's an obstacle course down there that the Navy will be competing against the Argo cheerleaders and the public and the Marine Police, etc. So it's going to be a very jam-packed, full Canada Day weekend.
So I'm here with David in front of the Draken. David, tell us your involvement with the festival and where you're coming from and where you're going.
Okay. So Draken is a reconstruction of a Viking ship. It was built in Norway. We sailed from Norway following the Viking routes to Faroe Islands, Iceland, Greenland, and then to Newfoundland. That took a total of 2 months. And then we continued then down to St. Lawrence, and we're here in Toronto for the Tall Ship Festival. Okay, so the ship is named after Harald Fairhair, who was the first king of Norway. He was the man who united Norway as one kingdom. And it's written in the sagas that he had a huge long ship with a large red sail. So that was the kind of idea behind this ship being built. It was built in Haugesund, Norway, finished in 2012. And it's not a direct reconstruction of any one Viking ship, but they've taken evidence from found Viking ships, and also from the Norwegian boat building tradition.
Mm-hmm. Now you are powered as well, right, by engine?
Yeah.
Makes it legal, yeah. Most of the time when you're crossing the ocean, you're coming across by sail?
Yes, correct, yeah.
The oars are more ceremonial, I guess, eh?
Yeah, rowing is to be done in flat water, for example, going into a fjord or an anchorage or whatever, that's when you can use the oars. But when there's any kind of swell, it's really pretty much impossible to row anyway. So it's all about sailing, yeah. And the idea of the Vikings rowing over oceans is nonsense, I believe.
And as far as the total trip you're on here, the tour, how long will you be away from home?
I left home in April, and I'll be back again in November, I think. So it's a long trip, yeah. But it's been 2 months to here now.
Good. And are you? What do you think? Are you going to do some touring around Toronto and enjoy Toronto a little bit while you're here?
Yeah.
I'm here with Eric aboard the Kingston. Eric, tell us a little bit about what you're doing at the Red Path Festival and a little bit about the ship.
Sure. All right. So HMCS Kingston, we came here at the Red Path Festival in Toronto as it's more as an advertising mission. So we're here to advertise the Navy to people that might not know what we do in the Navy, and also to tell the story of the Navy itself. And as well, we're here to recruit new personnel if they want to join the Navy, full-time or part-time, as I am, part-time reservist. And it's pretty much our mission here in Kingston. There's a huge festival going on in the waterfront, Toronto, close to a pier here. We're docked right next to an obstacle course, so if people want to come here and just participate in the races or just in the festivities themselves, they're more than welcome to come here.
And Eric, what's the length of the ship, and tell me a little bit about the ship.
So the ship itself, it's called an MCDV. It's quite a small ship with 45 crew personnel, roughly 50 meters length, and it's used for mostly for patrols, so for fisheries patrol, as well as just submarine patrol or just patrolling the shoreline. So that's mainly our purpose. MCDV stands for Maritime Coastal Defense Vessel. There's 12 of them in the Navy, 6 per coast, and we're based in Halifax, Nova Scotia.
We're here with Gary Knight at the Port of Orillia for the Chris Craft Rendezvous. Gary, this is the third rendezvous you've done?
Yes, this is the third year.
So Gary, tell us a little bit about how you got started with the rendezvous and where you're coming from. And
right. Well, the first year, my buddy Gord and I, we both own Chris Crafts, and we just thought it'd be a good idea to get together with some other Chris Craft owners. So the first year was kind of an ad hoc adventure, and we used our marina gas dock. We had three boats. And then last year we got a little more formal with it, had it here at Port of Orillia, and we had 26 boats. So this being the third year, it's something that we want to keep going year after year. And it's just nice to get together with other Chris Craft owners and socialize and talk all things Chris Craft.
So tell me about your boat.
Well, this is a 1967 36 foot Chris Craft Cavalier. We've owned it since 2000, so we're the third owner.
Do all your own work on the boat?
Do all my work myself, for the most part, yes.
Beautiful shape.
Thank you. This is all original from 1967. Obviously bedding and things like that is not original, but as you see it is as it was built in 1967.
I'm here with Glory and Gord. Tell us a bit about your boat.
Well, this is the Jessna 3. It's a 1966 40-foot Constellation made by Chris Craft in Algonac, Michigan.
We love it.
It's your baby, eh?
Yeah.
Yes.
How long have you owned it for?
About 14 years now.
Wow. Keep it nice shape.
Thank you. Yeah. All his hard effort.
Beautiful boat.
Thank you. Okay, this is a sterling silver ring that Gordy inset some mahogany. So it's my Chris Craft ring. It's one of a kind, and I love it. So.
And is that mahogany off a real Chris Craft?
Yes, it is.
Wow.
Yes,
that's
it
cool.
is. It's he got it off an old boat that was being put to junk, I guess, and he took a segment off of it and made this beautiful ring for me.
Tell me about your boat.
1986 Chris Craft Commander.
Take care of it yourself?
We did,
yeah.
We've had it now for 4 years. It's been on Lake Simcoe most of its life, but gets out to Georgian Bay from time to time.
Where's your home port?
We live in Sutton, but we keep the boat on Virgin Island.
Oh, okay. Neat. Cool.
It's kind of cool.
Very nice boat.
We take our little boat, which we call the pilot boat, to the big boat.
Okay. Nice boat.
Thank you very much.
Okay. Tell us a little bit about your boat.
Yep, it's a 1964 Chris Craft Constellation, and we've owned it for 10 years.
Do all your own work on it?
Yeah.
Beautiful boat.
Huh?
Beautiful boat.
Thanks.
Yeah. Your dog's name?
Connie.
Connie.
Constellation Connie.
Constellation Connie, that's great.
Yeah.
Yeah. And where did it come from originally? Where did it...
The Shanahan Motors bought it originally in 64. We know a bit of the history of it. They only owned it a couple of years, and then the Rogers family bought it. Ted Rogers' brother, Greg Rogers, bought the boat, and they owned it for many, many years. And he actually died at the helm on the boat, backed into the slip at Keswick, and died at the helm.
From a heart attack. Oh, that's an interesting story.
Story.
No ghosts on your boat, eh?
Well,
good ones.
Huh?
Good ghosts.
And as far as the engines in it stuff, what's it powered by?
440 Chryslers. It's got a 7.5 kilowatt generator. All the hydro and plumbing has been updated on it. It's got central air. Great modern features as well.
Beautiful boat.
Stay tuned as Boating Georgian Bay tours the Orillia Inn Water Boat Show.
I'm here with Mark Sharpley at Pride Marine. Mark, tell us a little bit about the show.
Well, it's a great 3-day event where it gives everyone an opportunity to come and view our boats, check out the different brands that we carry, and go for a test ride if you want to.
Mark, tell us about your sponsor boat here. What's going on?
Well, this particular boat, and we always lend a boat to Jeff St. Clair, who's water on the water, beer on the pier. And multiple sponsors go on the vessel, and Jeff takes the boat where all our boat shows are, where events happen on Simcoe, Cooch, Georgian Bay. It's just a great opportunity for people to see this wonderful scenery out on the water.
And do you do live stuff as well, or is it just attend rendezvous and travel around and stuff like that?
Jeff does all his marine weather reports off the boat every morning, every Friday, Saturday, Sunday. There's a contest. He does giveaways. He travels to the rendezvous. He goes to, this year we're going to be having the Acapalooza in Penetang Bay. And so he'll be there as well, giving out prizes.
Mark, what are your expectations from the show?
You know what? Expectations are all based upon the weather. We have a great weather weekend. We usually have a great weekend. And it's a, like I said, it's a great opportunity to get all kinds of leads for future boat purchases.
I'm here with Steve at Superior Textiles. Steve, tell me a little bit about your plastique product.
Well, we've got 21 different colors. It's a PVC. There's about a 10-year warranty on it. It doesn't fade, crack, or peel. We are the only ones that manufacture right here in Barrie, Ontario. We don't send patterns off anywhere to get done.
Canadian-made product.
Canadian-made.
Great stuff. So we're here with BoatDealers.ca. Tell us about why you're here, and maybe give us a little synopsis on the state of the union as far as how it's going with boat sales and things like that right now.
Great. We're here in Orillia. We do both boat shows here each year. And it's to support our dealer network that lists all of their new and used inventory with us on the BoatDealers.ca listing site. We're having an excellent year. Our traffic is up from about 1.1 million viewers last year to 1.3, close to 1.4 million viewers coming to our site looking at boats this year.
Finding a lot of American viewers now?
We are a .ca site, so we don't really cater to the U.S. market. The last Google analytics I saw showed about just over 300,000 U.S. visitors, and they looked at about 1.2 million pages. So I think they're probably taking advantage of the dollar in used boats.
Yeah.
It's mostly used boats. I've talked to three or four of our dealers in this marketplace here, a couple in Midland, and a lot of their bigger boats are going to U.S. customers. They're, it's because of the dollar.
Yeah, yeah.
This makes for good value.
Yeah. Thanks very much for taking the time to talk to us.
No problem.
The other neat thing about the Orillian Water Boat Show is you can sign up for free and take a boat handling course, both close quarters and like beginner, and more advanced as well. And they take you out and let you play around in the boats and give you some instruction on how to better manage your boat in close quarter docking situations.
Welcome to the Gravenhurst Inn Water Boat Show.